नमस्कार फ्रेंड्स, वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून टू ऑल ऑफ यू। इसके लिए स्टडी सर्कल के इस वेबिनार में आप सभी पार्टिसिपेंट का बहुत ही स्वागत है। फ्रेंड्स, आज के जो हमारे स्पीकर हैं डॉक्टर सी ए ध्रुव राकेश गुप्ता जी, सी ए स्वामी अग्रवाल जी, दोनों आ चुके हैं आज। सर, आप दोनों का स्वागत है, वेलकम सर। हमारे बीच हमारे फाउंडर कन्वेनर डॉक्टर सी ए दुर्गादास अग्रवाल जी भी आ चुके हैं। सर, आपका भी स्वागत है।
नमस्कार
फ्रेंड्स, आज का जो टॉपिक है हमारा, इट इज एन आर्ट ऑफ लीडिंग इन असेसमेंट एंड रीअसेसमेंट विद इनकम टैक्स एक्ट। इट्स रियली एन आर्ट। हम कॉमर्स में भी हम आर्ट की बात कर रहे हैं, तो ये आर्ट ही है। आप एक नॉर्मल प्लेड करते हो, एक आपको सब चीज आते हुए भी कई बार क्या होती है, आपके पास नॉलेज होती है बट आप उसको प्लीड नहीं कर पाते हो, आप बता नहीं पाते हो, उसको एक्सप्रेस नहीं कर पाते हो। एक बार कई नॉलेज ठीक है, ठीक ठाक सी है, बट उसकी प्लीडिंग बहुत अच्छी होती है। तो बहुत सारे फीचर्स होते हैं और हमारे बीच बहुत सारी इंट्रिकेसीज भी होती है, छोटी छोटी बातें होती है, कई सारी इंपॉर्टेंट बातें होती है जिसको आपको ख्याल रखना पड़ता है, कब करना है, क्या करना है, क्यों करना है, सिचुएशन कैसी होती है और डॉक्यूमेंटेशन कैसी है, बहुत सारी चीजें होती है, तो उसको हमें ध्यान रखना होता है फ्रेंड्स। और हम में से कई सारे प्रैक्टिस में भी होंगे, कई सारे ऑलरेडी असेसमेंट रीअसेसमेंट अपील सारी चीजें कर रहे होंगे, तो इन्हीं सब चीजों को ख्याल रखते हुए हमारे जो आपस में डिस्कशन हुई, तो डीडीजी ने जो सजेशन दिया, तो वी हैव वन ऑफ द बेस्ट स्पीकर जो हमारी मतलब आप जोड़ी में बोले तो हमारे बीच एक्सपीरियंस्ड सेटल्ड डॉक्टर सी राकेश गुप्ता जी हैं, एंड साथ ही साथ हमारे बीच वेरी यंग डायनेमिक नॉलेजेबल सी ए स्वामी अग्रवाल जी भी हमारे बीच। तो आज हमारे बीच दोनों हैं और हमें बहुत ही अच्छी नॉलेज मिलने वाली है। एंड आई वुड लाइक टू रिक्वेस्ट ऑल फ्रेंड्स, ऑल पार्टिसिपेंट, कि प्रोग्राम को जितना इंटरेक्टिव हो, जैसे आप लोग शुरू से करते हैं, वो कल भी जितना आपने इंटरेक्टिव रखा, आप प्लीज उसको इंटरेक्टिव उतना रखिएगा, सो दैट आप ज्यादा से ज्यादा उसका बेनिफिट ले सकें। तो प्रोग्राम की हम विधिवत शुरुआत करते हैं। विधिवत शुरुआत करने के लिए मैं अपने फाउंडर कन्वेनर श्री दुर्गादास अग्रवाल जी को इनवाइट करना चाहूंगा। सर, आप आए, प्लीज प्रोग्राम की शुरुआत करें, साथ ही साथ एक परिचय जरूर दें। ऑलरेडी परिचय की जरूरत है नहीं दोनों को, लेकिन फिर भी सर आप अपने तरफ से जरूर करें। ओवर टू यू सर।
थैंक यू संदीप। संदीप शर्मा ऑफ आवर कन्वीनर ऑफ स्टडी सर्किल, रेस्पेक्टेड सी ए डॉक्टर राकेश गुप्ता जी, सी एस सोमिल अग्रवाल जी, आपने कहा परिचय की बात, तो मैं समझता हूं कि इंटेलेक्चुअल्स में इन दोनों का जवाब नहीं है। क्या सी ए, सी एस, आई सी डब्ल्यू ए, पी एच डी, एल एल बी, डॉक्टरेट, और सोमिल तो इसके अलावा एल एल एम भी है, तो और आई टी आई टी मेंबर रह चुके हैं राकेश जी, और शायद 2002-03 से मैं राकेश जी को सुन रहा हूं। 18-20 साल का लंबा सफर हो गया, तो जो बातें जो आज हमने जो चैप्टर का नाम रखा है डिस्कशन का, आर्ट ऑफ लीडिंग, जैसे पढ़ते हैं आर्ट है या साइंस है, साइंस होती है नॉलेज की, कैसे ऐसे करेंगे तो क्या रिजल्ट आएगा, और आर्ट होती है एक आर्ट के उसको कैसे हम अच्छे से तस्तरी में परोसें। तो यही चीज है कि जो भी हम असेसमेंट या रीअसेसमेंट में जब हम अपनी पहले तो अपील फाइल करें, तो ब्रीफ में क्या ग्राउंड हमें अपनी अपील बनानी है, उसके बाद पेपर बुक जो बनानी है, हमें किस चीज पे लड़ना है, हमें जबरदस्ती की फालतू चीजें नहीं देनी है, क्या करना है, किस चीज को एम्फेसाइज करना है, तो ये ऐसी जो निटी ग्रिटी जो छोटी छोटी बातें हैं जो कि बहुत महत्वपूर्ण होती है आगे चल के अब अपने केस को स्ट्रॉन्ग करने के लिए, उन चीजों के डिस्कशन के लिए कि आज हमारा सौभाग्य है कि हमारे बीच में राकेश गुप्ता जी और सोमिल जी हैं। तो मैं बहुत ज्यादा समय नहीं लूंगा। पार्टिसिपेंट्स मैं देख रहा हूँ 111 आ चुके हैं, आप सभी पार्टिसिपेंट्स का बहुत बहुत स्वागत। आज मौसम भी लिटिल बिट बेटर है कल से, हल्की हल्की धूप निकल रही है, मौसम भी ठीक है। राकेश जी तो कोलकाता गए हुए हैं किसी काम से और वहां से ज्वाइन किया है उन्होंने। राकेश जी आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, थैंक यू वेरी मच सर, बहुत बहुत स्वागत। सोमिल जी आपका भी बहुत बहुत स्वागत और पार्टिसिपेंट्स का भी बहुत बहुत स्वागत। मैं ज्यादा समय ना लेते हुए राकेश जी से विनती करूंगा कि वो थोड़े से कार्यक्रम की एक सेमिनार की एक स्ट्रक्चरिंग थोड़ी सी आप रूपरेखा बनाएं और जैसे भी उचित समझें, पहले सोमिल या आप, योगी है, तो आपका स्वागत करते हुए बस रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा कि शुरुआत आप करें सर। थैंक यू,
थैंक यू, थैंक यू डीडी साहब, थैंक यू संदीप जी फॉर हैविंग स्पोकन सच गुड वर्ड्स फॉर अस, फॉर बोथ ऑफ अस, दे आर द प्रेशियस ट्रेजर फॉर अस। फ्रेंड्स, in this corona pandemic we all are substantially confined to our respective places, and I got invitations from Eastern India Regional Council to address a webinar / seminar tomorrow, which is partially physical and partially it will be through the virtual platform, so it is an hybrid. So I had come yesterday to Calcutta, I mean to take some shelter from the Delhi's chilling cold. Here the weather is very pleasant, and in the morning when I sent my messages, so I said one thing, that if the corona has created havoc with our lives, but certain things which are good it has given, and one of them is that you can connect yourself from wherever you are. I am in Kolkata, in my hotel. Somil is in Delhi, in Faridabad, and DD Sahab and Sandeep Ji are in Delhi. So, friends, the topic, as DD Sahab has told, art of pleadings in assessment and reassessment. As all of you know, that the assessment and reassessment now both have become faceless, and. Therefore, the question which crops up in our mind is as to whether there is any shift in this art of pleading as compared to a situation when we used to appear before the assessing officer bodily. Of course, though in pith and substance there is not much difference, but practically, yes, there is a difference. In as much as now, since we would not sit across the table before the assessing officer, so many things which used to be conveyed through our bodily presence before him, and we could appreciate, we could understand, we could read the reaction of an assessing officer as to whether he has appreciated the point which we are trying to make him understand, now that will not be available. Therefore, as I said a couple of days back when I and Somil spoke on the first appeal practical approach, that our pleadings, our written submissions, our letters, our submissions, now though were always very important, even in a situation when we used to represent physically before the assessing officer, but in the faceless regime, now our pleadings, our submissions, our letters, writings, now it has assumed all the more importance, because now there will not be any occasion for us to interact physically, bodily before the assessing officer. We would not be able to understand and appreciate the action and reaction of the assessing officer. Now, what will be there before the assessing officer is our pleadings, is our submissions, is our letter. Therefore, how to draft those pleadings now is anybody's guess. It has to be very vocal. It has to be very comprehensive. And therefore, we thought that we must put this topic, which will be of importance to all of us, because most of us doing practice on the income tax side are obviously representing the cases of our clients before the income tax officer. So I would first of all request Somil to share his experience in the matter of preparation of the pleadings, either during the course of assessment and during the course of reassessment. And I'm quite sure that after the deliberations of Somil, which will be punctuated, which will be explained, which will be elaborated by me, I humbly feel that the audience, our professional friends, may get some important inputs. So with this prelude, with this background, with this context, which I have laid, now I would request Somil to kindly start his deliberations on this topic, art of pleadings in assessment and reassessment. Somil.
Thank you, sir. My guru, Dr. Rakesh Gupta, sir, D.D. Agarwal, sir, Sandeep, sir, and my dear friends. So in this new regime of virtual mode and faceless assessment, as rightly said by sir, the art of pleading, the drafting, the preparation, the submissions which you have to place on record, now that the assessing officer is basically the computer in front of you. So your replies, your submissions have gained a lot of importance. Law of pleading must be adhered to without any fail. Now, law of pleading requires that the factual evidences, factual submissions, your factual averments should be placed before the court of original jurisdiction. Now, in the income tax proceedings, the court of original jurisdiction is the assessing officer. So all the factual pleadings, factual submissions should be placed before the assessing officer. I remember in my initial days, starting the practice, the first lesson that I learned was that the assessment is the foundation. The pleadings, the evidences which are brought on record during the course of assessment proceedings will go a long way in helping you to plead your case in an effective and proper manner. Now, before the assessing officer, whatever evidences you have, whatever facts you want to bring on record, because any claim, any deduction, any exemption which the assessee is claiming, the burden is on the assessee to prove it. And the facts, the evidences which are close to the assessee, which are in the knowledge of the assessee, then it is expected the assessee to bring them on record. So during the course of assessment, in your pleadings, in your evidences, all the factual pleadings and evidences should be placed on record. Say, for example, in case of credit in the bank account, Section 68 requires assessee to prove the identity, creditworthiness, and genuineness of the transaction, and to further go on, source of the source. So confirmation, return, the capacity of that person, return, balance sheet, all the documents which can support the transaction. They should all be brought on record by the assessee before the AO himself. The onus should be discharged and all the evidences which the assessee has should be brought on record. Sir, the assessee, in fact, in a lighter way, I can say that the evidences, the voluminous evidences that the assessee has, should be brought on record and let the assessing officer be lost in the evidences. Our attempt should be to burden the file of the assessing officer, to fully load the file of the assessing officer with all the evidences that we have. Say, for example, in case of commission expense, while substantiating the commission expenses paid by the assessee, the confirmation should be filed. Along with that, what is the nature of service that has been rendered? Supporting evidences for that, say they are mail communications, their correspondences, the services have been rendered by the assessee, which has helped the assessee to render some further service. So even that should be put on record. All evidences, factual, corroborative, supportive, even circumstantial, all types of evidences with pleadings, they should be brought on record before the assessing officer. Now, whatever factual assertion we are making, that should be supported by corroborative evidence. So kindly note, any factual assertion without any supporting evidence can be treated as a bald assertion. So whatever you state on facts should be supported by a corroborative evidence to substantiate the same. So the first principle, the foundation, the thumb rule that the factual pleadings, factual submissions should be brought, should be placed before the court of original jurisdiction, that is the assessing officer. Now, in case the evidences are not filed before the assessing officer, it is not a case that everything is lost. It is not a case. Obviously, before the appellate authority, you can file the fresh evidences, additional evidences before the appellate authority. And in cases where the evidences are not placed before the assessing officer, that necessitates the requirement of filing of petition of additional evidence before the appellate authorities. Now, the powers of the appellate authority to entertain additional evidence in case of first appeal, that is governed by Rule 46 capital A, and the assessee is required to prove, to show, to justify that what was the reason that prevented the assessee from bringing the evidences on record before the assessing officer. So under Rule 46 capital A, those four clauses, whether where number one, the assessee was prevented by sufficient cause to produce the evidence called upon by the assessing officer, or the assessee was prevented by sufficient cause to bring on record evidences which are relevant for any ground of appeal, the assessing officer passed the order without giving any proper sufficient opportunity of hearing, or the assessing officer refused to admit the evidence. So that limitation comes in where the assessee is faced, is in a situation where the additional evidence petition is required to be filed. Sir, had these evidences, once the evidences are, all the evidences are placed before the assessing officer, then the assessee, the authorized representative, can impress upon, can rely upon those documents as a matter of right before the appellate authorities. But once those documents, those factual evidences are not placed before the assessing officer, the court of original jurisdiction, and it necessitates the position of additional evidences, then sir, make it a, it would be a situation where half the battle is lost. In that situation, the assessee, the case has been put in a disadvantageous situation. I'm not saying everything is, it is a lost thing, but an additional hurdle has been added. Instead of impressing upon the appellate authority to go into the merit of that evidences, now the first requirement, the first hurdle that has to be crossed is that the assessee will have to justify the reason why those evidences could not be placed before the assessing officer. And then the appellate authority, if convinced on the touchstone of say 46 capital A in respect of first appeal, Rule 29 of the Income Tax Tribunal rule for the appellate tribunal. So if they are satisfied, then obviously they can admit the additional evidences. Now say, CIT appeal does not admit the evidences. In that case, the assessee will have to file further appeal to the Honorable Tribunal. And then Honorable Tribunal, which takes a more holistic view, and in case it, tribunal feels that in, for the cause of substantial justice, yes, these evidences have to be admitted, then sir, again, the tribunal, what the tribunal would do is admit the evidences and send that back to the assessing officer. So whole of that process of 3 to 5 years where the assessee or the counsel could have immediately could have brought that evidences on record at the first stage before the AO. Now, after 5 years of all those efforts, will go back to the assessing officer for another round. So that will bring that entails costs, resources for the assessee and the number of times it is seen that these evidences which are available and for somehow reasons which may not be justifiable have not been brought before the assessing officer. So the first thing, the very important thing is that all the factual assertions, factual evidences should be brought before the assessing officer. I remember, sir, there was a matter in which this bank, the assessee's bank account, there were several credit entries. The assessing officer asked the SSC to show and to substantiate the credit entries, tell the nature and substantiate it. Now, during the course of assessment proceedings, SSC did not file sufficient evidences. I remember that at least 15-20 opportunities were given to the SSC, but the evidences were somehow not brought on record. Now, when the matter came for the first appeal, so the first challenge was to gather the evidences for supporting the entries in the bank statement. Those amounts were received, like loan were received, or amount which was earlier given as loan was received back. All those kinds of evidences were entries were there, and for which substantial documents were available, and further evidences were collected and were available. Even third party evidences were available. But the challenge that came was that despite 15 odd opportunities by the assessing officer, why these evidences were not brought before the assessing officer. So while discussion with the client, I could, once I was listening to the client continuously, I could figure out that the SSC has been undergoing number of medical concerns over the last couple of years. So while asking the SSC to give me all those records, what we couldn't find is that during the course of assessment proceedings, when the assessing officer was granting the opportunities, it was due to the SSC's medical condition that the SSC was not able to substantiate and bring all those evidences on record. And on that basis, we filed that petition under Rule 46 capital A. And with that petition, we ensured that all the corroborative evidence to prove that the SSC was not in a condition to bring all those evidence on record were placed before the first appellate authority. So be it your facts, your claims or deductions, or even in the applications, whatever factual assertion, whatever factual pleading you take, that should be corroborated by a proper evidence. So appropriate pleading at the appropriate stage, that is the assessing officer, is the rule of the law of pleading. I remember, sir, there was a matter in High Court, and it was in respect of share application, money, share capital, share premium. Now, assessing officer had sent 133.6, 131 notices, which were not complied with by the share applicants and the shareholders. Now, the question their lordships asked that why were the, if they are your shareholders, and why are they not cooperating? So the argument that we conveyed was that, my lords, you may kindly see the position of the company for over last 5-6 years. And the company has not been able to perform as per the expectations of the shareholder. The company has been in losses. The projections, the proposals that we showed to the share applicant shareholders at the time of taking the share application money and the premium, that the company could not come up to those expectations, to all those projections, and we have incurred losses. And therefore, those shareholders have not responded so as to give punishment to the company for not performing. And they are genuine shareholders, and they are all existing. The question that my lords asked was that, can you show us one pleading and the evidence before the authorities below? So, sir, that was not there in that case. Those pleadings, those evidences, those material on record, factual pleadings before the AO, even said the appeal, that was not there. And therefore, the lordship held that you have now missed the bus. And therefore, the factual pleadings and assertions should be there at the first stage. All your evidences should be placed before the assessing officer. Let him be lost in these evidences. And sir, kindly note, as the SSC, I am not required to give inferences to the assessing officer. What all I am required to do is to bring on record the evidences to support my claims. The drawing of inferences is the prerogative of the assessing officer. It is not the duty of the SSC to give the appearances. So my task is to bring all my material before the assessing officer, and if he does not accept my claim, then obviously as a matter of right, I can impress upon, I can rely upon those evidences before the appellate authorities to say that my claim should be allowed. Despite this, sir, in case of deficiencies in the assessment proceedings, deficiencies can be taken care of in the penalty proceedings as well. Honorable Supreme Court, in the case of Anantaram Veer Sangaiya, 123 ITR, page 457. Have held that the penalty proceedings are independent and separate from the assessment proceedings. The findings of the assessment order are relevant, but they are not conclusive of the matter. And in the penalty proceedings, if the assessee, due to some reason, has not been able to bring on record material evidences to support the claim, can very well furnish them in the penalty proceedings. The assessing officer cannot be heard saying, oh, you did not bring it in the assessment proceedings, you are barred from bringing in the penalty proceedings. That is not the case, sir. You can very well file in the penalty proceedings. In fact, recently, Honorable Supreme Court, the judgment delivered on 23rd April 2020, Bashir Ahmed Sisodia, wherein the quantum appeal was pending before the Honorable Supreme Court. And in that case, the issue was that the assessee had made some purchases, and with respect to creditors, the assessee was not able to bring supporting evidences to prove the genuineness of the creditors. Some of the notices which were served by the assessing officer, they were not complied with. And accordingly, addition was made, and that was confirmed till the stage of Honorable Tribunal being the final fact-finding authority. Now, while the matter was before Honorable High Court, the penalty was being levied by the, had been levied by the assessing officer on the same set of facts. Now, in the penalty appeal in this case, the assessee moved additional evidences, brought new confirmations from the creditors, and even statements were recorded of the creditors to support the claim of the assessee. Now, on the basis of those evidences, the CIT appeal deleted the penalties. Now, that very order of the Learned CIT appeal, which was not challenged by the department, that was filed as part of additional document before the Honorable Supreme Court when the quantum appeal was pending there. Honorable Supreme Court took cognizance of that order. The factual findings in that order were so stark that the Honorable Supreme Court held that the findings given in this order and the fact that the assessing officer has not challenged this order before the tribunal goes on to show that the addition itself deserves to be deleted. Now, sir, this has been a normal rule that once addition is deleted, penalty does not have any legs to stand. It has to go. However, in this case, penalty was deleted, which went on to help the assessee to get the addition deleted. So the deficiencies, the inadequacies which crept in during the assessment proceedings can be taken care of, can be complied with in the penalty proceedings also. So, during the course of assessment proceedings, penalty proceedings, first appellate, your factual submissions, your factual assertions, factual pleadings, all evidences should come on record. Now, the question arises, what about the legal issues? Sir, in one line, if I can say, legal issues can wait, but the factual issues, factual pleadings, evidences cannot wait, and they should not wait. They should be placed before the AO as early as possible. However, the legal objections, the legal issues, Honorable Supreme Court in NTPC 229 ITR page 383, again reiterated in Singhal Technical Education Society 397 ITR page 344, it has been a settled position that legal issues can be raised for the first time before any appellate authority at any time by the assessee. but there should be no requirement of fresh investigation of facts. If the facts are on record, the legal issues can be raised at any point of time. However, some legal issues, some legal objections, which the statute mandates that should be raised before the assessing officer in a particular manner, prescribed manner as per the statute, those should be raised before the assessing officer. Sir, I'm conscious that in the regime of faceless assessment, one may think that these jurisdictional issues, objections, how far is their relevance now? But we are aware that search cases, 148 assessment are still to be done in physical mode, in the earlier mode. And even in the faceless regime also, you may kindly note, even in the faceless regime, the NFAC, the National Faceless Assessment Center, is to carry out the assessment proceeding in the faceless manner. However, the 148 notice, the notice under section 143(2) to process the return filed in response to 148 notice, these have to be issued by the jurisdictional assessing officer. And subsequent to that, the case is transferred to the NFAC for assessment proceeding. So jurisdictional notices under 148, 143(2), these are in the reassessment proceedings, have to be issued by the jurisdictional assessing officer even today. So the legal objections, objection where the territorial jurisdiction of the assessing officer, jurisdiction to issue notice itself is to be challenged, then section 124 subsection 3 requires that no person shall be allowed to call in question the jurisdiction of the assessing officer unless the person has raised objection within a period of 1 month of service of such notice. So 124 subsection 3 has to be complied with if the assessee is challenging the very jurisdiction of the assessing officer to issue the notice. Now, similarly, now service of notice. Sir, section 292 double B we have in the Act, which provides that if the assessee has participated, cooperated in the procedure assessment or reassessment and has not objected, then any defect in respect of service of notice, service in time, service in appropriate manner cannot be called in question unless the assessee has objected before the completion of the assessment proceedings. Now, with respect to the objection in respect of the service of notice to overcome the hurdle of 292 BB, the objection, even if placed at the fag end, just before the completion of the assessment proceedings, that would comply with the requirement of 292 BB. But if the assessment order is passed and the objection in respect of service of notice is not raised, then 292 BB clearly mandates that the service would be deemed to be in accordance with law. Now the question arises in respect of section 143(2) notice. Even in fact, yesterday only I was going reading a matter wherein the notice of 143(2) was issued after the time limit. The question, the learned CITP had dismissed the appeal on the ground that 292 BB assessee has cooperated and therefore this cannot be called in question. Sir, my humble submission is this, that 292 BB cures only service of notice. It does not cure the issuance, the defect of issuance. And it is a settled law that non-issuance of 143(2) would render the proceeding invalid. It is not a procedural irregularity. It is a jurisdictional defect, which will go to the very root of the assessment proceeding and would be treated as an invalid proceeding. So, Honorable Supreme Court, in the case of Lakshman Das Khandelwal, in a recent judgment, 417 ITR, page 325, have held that 292 BB only cures service of notice. It does not cure the absence or non-issuance of notice in time. Similarly, even Delhi High Court in Silver Line, 383 ITR, page 455, have held it. So issuance of notice, legal objections, and now these issues that this notice has not been issued, or legal objection with respect to the time bar, notice being issued, time barred, being barred by limitation. All those legal issues, they can be raised at any point of time. In fact, before the assessing officer, except those legal issues which the statute mandates should be raised before the AO in order to make sure that the SSC is able to challenge the very jurisdiction itself, which are required as per the conditions of the statute, except those, other legal issues can be taken up even before the appellate authorities for the first time. Sir, the pleadings, the evidences which should be brought on record, number of times it has been our experience, even in case of, say, for example, stay petitions. Generally, we file petitions, sir, the SSC's financial position is not good. SSC will not be able to, if the demand is recovered, it would lead to irreparable loss to the SSC. But it has been our experience that the supporting evidences, the corroborative evidences to support the claim, those are missing. We should file our latest balance sheets to show that, yes, the financial conditions is poor. We should bring evidences on record to show that, yes, if the demand is recovered, it would cause irreparable losses. The liabilities on the SSC should be brought before the assessing officer, the immediate liabilities which he has to pay off, the business difficulties which SSC wants to show. So whatever factual assertion, factual averment we want to make, it should be supported by proper corroborative evidences. So law of pleading requires that all the factual pleadings should be brought before the assessing officer at the earliest instance. Sir, pleadings of the sort like the example that I was taking, say for a commission example that I took. Now, if that commission has been paid to a party with whom the SSC has been having transactions over a period of time in earlier years, in subsequent years, and this commission has been paid to such person in all those years and this has been accepted, then that pleading should come on record. Similarly, say creditors, purchases SSC has made, assessing officer calls upon to prove the purchases. Now, creditors payments have been made in subsequent years. Then all those ledger accounts of subsequent years, the payments given to them through banking channels, your running account, those all should be placed before the assessing officer to show that these creditors have been even paid. The purchases are completely genuine. So during the assessment proceedings, the main task, we chartered accountants are master of facts. And the art of pleading, the art of anticipating what all evidences we can have, what all evidences we can bring on record to prove our claim, all those should be placed before the court of original jurisdiction, that is the assessing officer. So that even if he rejects my claim before the appellate authorities, I can rely upon those evidences as a matter of my right. And I will not be hinging upon the judicial discretion of the appellate authorities to admit those evidences if not placed before the assessing officer. So, sir, this is what I wanted to share in respect of the art of pleadings and my experience over the years. So with this, I'll request, sir, to take it forward, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Somil, for, as usual, laying down the floor and the foundation for today's deliberations. As Somil has said, that we chartered accountants are the master of facts. Nobody else can put the facts as we can. And therefore, we must ensure that the facts relating to a particular thing which we want to prove must come on record. And therefore, I always say that we should know that burden of proof lies on whom. Because the pleading on facts now would depend upon as to whether the burden lies on me to prove a particular fact situation. So if the burden to prove a particular fact situation lies upon me, then of course all necessary facts in support of that fact must be brought on record by me. In case I am found wanting, in case I do not place them, then as Somile said, then we may be constrained to move additional evidence. We will have to own up one more responsibility as to what prevented us from not filing this evidence or this document or this, or to make this pleading before the assessing officer. And then the first appellate authority will adjudicate first of all, not on the merit of that issue, but then whether this evidence which you could not file, can it be said that you were prevented by sufficient cause from producing it? And I tell you, I have seen and I see day in and day out very good cases being lost at the appellate stage for the reason that additional evidences which we sought to file before the appellate authority are not admitted to be filed or are not admitted for consideration by the appellate authority. That is why, as Somile said very nicely, that in respect of those facts which we want to prove and for which the burden of proof lies on our head and on our shoulders as an SSE, we must burden the file of the assessing officer. We should visualize, we should comprehend, we should envisage in our wisdom as a chartered accountant as to which evidences will be required to prove this fact. Ask our clients, bring this evidence. At times, it is very difficult even for us to convince the client, or the clients are reluctant for whatever reasons, because to collect evidence is not a painless exercise. It is a painful exercise. Therefore, we'll have to convince the client that it is in your own interest. This is laying the foundation on which the entire building is to be constructed. That importance will have to be injected into the client. He has to, or we have to make our clients understand the importance of this preparatory work. So we must burden the file of the assessing officer to this extent that he is lost under the weight of the documents which we file. Now there can be documentary evidences to prove a fact. So if we want to prove a fact relating to, say, purchases, then of course it can be proved with the help of the documentary evidences. It can be proved with the help of the purchase invoices. It can be proved with the help of the transportation of that material and which have come the evidence of that. But then there are certain things which cannot be supported with any documentary evidence. There are so many fact situations. Now I want to say that my client was not aware about this provision of law, though, I mean, to take such kind of an argument may not be very easy, but then an SSE may not be aware at times about the position of law. And therefore, how to prove such kind of a factual situation where the client really was not aware? Now, this cannot be proved with the help of any documentary evidence. There cannot be any documentary evidence in support of this fact that the client was not aware. So in such a situation, Now, those fact situations which cannot be proved with the help of any documentary evidence, then we'll have to discover the circumstantial evidence. Evidence will be there. Then the circumstances must be there. So as the documentary evidences have to be enclosed with our pleadings, with our submissions, with our letter, the circumstantial evidence being an intangible evidence, being a non-visible evidence, so we will have to weave those circumstances in our letter. We'll have to bring out those circumstances in our submissions. So that if a person of an ordinary prudence reads those or goes through those circumstances, and then he can say, oh, yes, it makes sense. And thereby, as I said a little while ago, and Somil also said, that we chartered accountants are master of facts. Because the fact was, in this peculiar situation, that my client was not aware about the position of law, though often it is said that nobody can plead ignorance of law. But then in the matter of taxation laws, the courts have said that the kind of complexity is attached with the laws, taxation laws. Therefore, there may well be a situation where a person may not be aware about the correct position of law or even the very existence of law. It depends upon the facts. And therefore, when you have to prove the fact of the ignorance on the part of your client, then you will have to show it with the help of the circumstantial evidence. Therefore, the bottom line is, and this is the real art I'm telling you, I'm sharing you, if somebody asks me as to what is the niche area or what is my USP, I always say the USP is to visualize at the stage of assessment all those possible evidences which will be required in case this decision goes against me at the level of the assessing officer. This is the USP. So you should be, as a chartered accountant, as an authorized representative on behalf of your SSE, as an art of pleading, be in a position to visualize that if this is the issue, the burden rests on the SSE to prove. Therefore, what else can be the evidence? What more can be the evidence? And whatever evidences can be there on this horizon, on this earth, if I am permitted to say in a lighter vein, that I should be in a position to visualize, I should be in a position to impress upon my client, because after all, the evidences have to be brought by the client. We can just advise him that which can be the evidence, you should bring it. And then this is the sum and substance of the art of pleading at the assessment stage, at the penalty stage, or in respect of all those things where the law is that the law of pleading is that the evidence on facts, your averment on fact, must be proved before the court of original jurisdiction. And the court of original jurisdiction in the tax proceeding is that of the court of the assessing officer. Then second thing we have to bear in mind, that if an assessing officer has once asked, his duty is over. Now, if he has put some question on facts in a notice under section 142(1), then his duty is over. Then assessing officer is not expected, nor should you expect the assessing officer to repeat that question. Now, you cannot be heard saying at any stage thereafter, sir, assessing officer, though did ask this question, but did ask questions about 8 months back. No, once he has asked even a year back or 8 months back or any time during the course of assessment proceeding, his duty is over. We should ensure that the factual reply, the factual averment, the factual evidence in connection with that point are brought on record before assessing officer, at least before the conclusion of the assessment proceeding. I always say that the facts are like the arguments of God. So if you as the counsel and if you as the authorized representative miss to bring the arguments of God on record, then who else is to be blamed? And as Saumil has pointed out, that by not placing this evidence at this stage, though you were called upon by the assessing officer, or you were called upon because of the burden of proof is resting on your shoulders to prove a particular fact. Now, what do? You omit. You do not bring it on record. You somehow miss. But then this miss may be very costly and expensive for your client. Now, in that situation, what would happen? When you will become wiser, when you will go in for appeal before the appellate authority, then the appellate authority will ask, why did you not file this evidence? Why did you not take this factual pleading before the assessing officer or before the court of original jurisdiction? Then you will have to make out a case. You will have to make out a case. Sir, this was the peculiar circumstance because of which, and those four situations which Saumil pointed out, that the assessing officer refused to admit an evidence. You were prevented by sufficient cause when you were being called upon by the assessing officer to prove, or you were prevented by sufficient cause even otherwise, or a particular issue was decided against you without observing the principle of natural justice. So your entire energy, I always say, which could have been utilized for contesting a case on merit effectively, now that is being lost or wasted or used or abused for what? For bringing that evidence on record. So who is responsible for this? Therefore, in the matter of cash credits, like in many cases, the cash deposits were there, cash deposits are there, we may be called upon to prove. Or in the past also, we may have been called upon to prove. Our factual pleading probably was that this was the cash in hand available with me. How the cash in hand was built? It was built as a result of the sale proceeds. Sale could be made only with the help of purchases and stocks. So did I bring on record the evidence of purchases? Did I bring on record to prove that these purchases are genuine? Did I bring it on record the fact that all the payments of these purchases have been made through banking channel? Whether the books of accounts or the cash book copy was filed before the assessing officer, if there was a stock register, did I produce that stock register? Did I file that stock register? Now, therefore, whatever evidences can be there to prove a fact, and burden is on me because under Section 68, the burden to prove that there was a credit in my books of account is on me. Under Section 69, if the fact of investment is proved, then the source of investment is required to be proved by me, by my SSE. Similarly, as Saumil has said about the commission. In commission, the evidence of rendition of service is very important. Now, most of the times, what happens? We end up in proving the fact of the payment of commission. Sir, we paid commission. that commission agent has shown this in his income. He has shown it in his income tax return. But then, apart from the factum of that expenditure, what else is required to be proved? That this expenditure has been incurred for the purpose of my business. And how can that be proved? By producing the evidence of service. Burden is on me, because the general rule of burden of proof is that if I am claiming a deduction, if I am claiming a rebate, if I am claiming a relief, if I am claiming an exemption, the burden to prove is on me. All those facts which would prove that yes, I was entitled, the burden to prove is on me. This is for me. If I do not produce it before the assessing officer, before the first appellate authority, I want to make up this deficiency, the first appellate authority would say, oh, why did you miss the bus in the first instance? First of all, you tell me. And not only should you tell, but then you will have to prove it. Because the assessing officer did ask you on this date, or even if not on multiple dates, then at least he did ask on this and this date. You chose to be negligent. You chose to be casual. And therefore, now it cannot be admitted, because after all, the evidences after admission now need to be investigated by the assessing officer. So you deprived the assessing officer from making investigation or inquiry in relation to this evidence by not producing it before him. Similarly, relating to the expenses, burden again is on you, because after all, I am claiming these deductions against whether income from house property, whether against income under that capital gain, whether under the head income from other sources, or whether under the head income from business or profession. Burden is on me. This is for me to prove that this expenditure was not only incurred, but then this was incurred wholly and exclusively for the purpose of my business. Therefore, any claim which we make on account of any relief, rebate, exemption, deduction, burden is on me. And therefore, that burden must be discharged not only by making pleading, but also proving the pleading with the help of, as I said, either with the help of the direct and documentary evidence, or by the circumstantial evidence, or with the help of the documentary and circumstantial evidence. But then there can be certain fact situations for which there cannot be the documentary evidence. Suppose if you engage a commission agent and whom you pay for the purpose or for the service that he follows up your payments from the customer. Now, there may not be any written evidence for it. If there are written evidence that you did engage a person, he did make follow up with the customer, then payments were received. Or even if the payments were not received, at least the service of follow up was done by him. Then you can prove it. But suppose if there are no evidence for it, then what can be the next best evidence? The next best evidence is your pleadings on facts, the circumstances. And in certain situations, then you can think in terms of filing a duly sworn affidavit in support of that fact situation from the person, from that very person. Suppose if you engaged an agent for the purpose of making follow-up, and there is no direct or documentary evidence, then ask that agent to swear an affidavit detailing all facts which shows his engagement, which shows as to what nature of services he was engaged for, what is the nature of duties, where did he follow up the payments with which parties, and all those things, because that is the next best evidence. That may not be the best evidence. And then if a duly sworn affidavit goes unchallenged at the end of the assessing officer, then the law comes, and the law is that a duly sworn affidavit which goes unchallenged, uncountered, unmet by the other party, and which has not been trashed, which has not been rebutted with the help of any cross-examination, then the courts have said that since the affidavit is a duly sworn affidavit in the name of God, and a deponent who has sworn it in the name of God is found to have made a wrong statement, thereby he would make himself liable for making the wrong statement, which is technically called as perjury. And therefore the courts have said that we will have to give the affidavit a status, an elevated status of an evidence. So while making the pleading, in such fact situations, you can think in terms of bringing the affidavit on record. Now, there are certain things which you have to demand for. And in case you do not demand, and you do not make pleading to that effect an assessment, then you cause a serious prejudice to the cause of your client. What is that? To ask for the appointment of district valuation officer. District valuation officer, section 50C, if your SSE whom you are representing has sold some capital asset at a value which is less than the stamp duty value, then section 50C says that unless you challenge it before assessing officer, then the stamp duty value shall be deemed to be the full value of consideration. So the capital gain will be computed by taking that stamp duty value into account. Similarly, 43CA, that if you are representing a case of a real estate developer selling land or building or both for a consideration which is less than the stamp duty value, same provision. Here, there is a statutory edict and mandate for you. And that mandate is that you must raise objection before the assessing officer during the course of assessment, asking the assessing officer to appoint district valuation officer. Now, this is such an important pleading that if you do not raise, then there may well be the possibility, and not may well be the possibility, but then the strong possibility that you lose this right. You lose this right. Similarly, as Swamil has pointed out, a very important thing, though the possibility of that thing has diminished in the light of assessment proceeding having been made through the faceless regime, about the lack of territorial jurisdiction. Now, if the assessing officer from whom you have received the notice, now because of the faceless regime, you will receive the notice from that faceless center. Otherwise, it used to be there. See that if Ward 11 was having the jurisdiction on you, but then the notice comes from some other assessing officer, and this assessing officer who has issued the notice was not having territorial jurisdiction over you, then section 124, subsection 3 of the Income Tax Act says that unless you raise your objection within a period of 30 days, about the lack of territorial jurisdiction of the assessing officer, then you will be debarred from raising this objection at a later stage. So art of pleading would require you to know certain even position of law. Then you must have come across while representing the cases of your clients that the assessing officer seeks to rely upon some evidence against you. If such and such investigation department or SEBI have conducted some investigations, have found certain adverse things. Well, they may have found anything. They may have found moon or sun. But then unless the copies of that is given to me, but then he has tried to make out a case by giving such kind of a hint in his notice, and yet as the representative of the SSE, we do not ask for the copy of such material, then the law says you are aware. You are aware as to the contents of that material which has been collected. Otherwise, you would have asked for it. So art of pleading demands that you must ask for anything which is being relied against you. Even in the faceless regime, if an assessing officer's notice refers some evidence, some statements, then ask for the copies. Now you do not ask for the copy of some adverse some purported alleged adverse statement. Then there is a presumption that you know it. You know the contents of that. And therefore, later on, then you cannot be heard saying that you were not supplied the copy. Yes, you were to be supplied the copy had you demanded it. And despite your demand, this copy having not been supplied to you, then this will be for the appellate authority to see whether the copy is supplied to you, or if the copy has not been supplied, then what is the legal effect of the non-supply of this copy? But then, as an art of pleading, you must demand for it. You asked for the copy of a statement, the statement was supplied to you. And that statement now is very adverse to you. But then you have to demand cross-examination. Now you do not demand cross-examination. That statement which was collected by the department that was on oath, and that was a statement given by that person against you on oath in the name of God, you do not ask for the cross-examination. Then the thing which I said for an affidavit, now that will operate against you because there was a duly sworn statement against you, copy of which was given to you. You did not ask for the cross-examination. Cross-examination, though, is a matter of right. But this right will come into existence only when you demand for it. If you do not demand, then that right is lapsed, that right is lost. The law would come to help those who want to help themselves. If you are not found diligent, if you are not found alive on your rights, if you are found sleeping over your rights, then the law would not wake up. So the art of pleading would demand that in such a situation, you ask for the cross-examination. You ask for the cross-examination, it will not be given. Even if assessing officer issues notice to that person, he may not come. After all, that person is the witness of whom? The witness of the department. Because it is the department who collected that evidence at your back. They want to rely upon his statement. Therefore, that person is the witness of the assessing officer, witness of the revenue. Therefore, on demand of yours, assessing officer is duty bound to produce him for cross-examination. And in case assessing officer is not able to produce him, then that evidence which was collected at your back Now that has to be ignored. That is what the import, that is what the judicial decisions to that effect are. But then if you choose not to make a request for cross-examination, then that statement given by that person, that to an oath against you, now will be pressed against you. Then the next facet of art of pleading is that if you think that a witness is very material for you, but then you, being an ordinary citizen, cannot enforce the attendance of that person, then you can always make a request to the assessing officer, because after all, he represents the Union of India. He has been given the power under the Income Tax Act. He has got necessary wherewithal to enforce the attendance of a witness. And despite your request to make the presence of a person, if an assessing officer either does not issue the summon, or even if he issues the summon, but that witness does not come forward, then in that situation, it has to be, this situation has to be interpreted in your favor. It so happens, you borrowed funds from somebody, you repaid it, he is not in your control, or even if you may not have repaid it, but then still, that person does not want to come forward. He is evading. He is not cooperating. He is not extending any support and cooperation to you. But then the presence of that witness is very essential. Then you can make a request. Suppose you have made purchases. He has been paid. Because the assessment takes after, say, 2 years or so. Now that party has disappeared. Now you can make a request. And here are the evidences of his existence. I am giving you complete names, address, PAN number, TIN number, bank statement. Now, he is not in my control since he has been paid. I cannot enforce his attendance, and therefore, kindly summon that person at my cost. I am prepared to deposit the necessary fee or diet money. And in that situation, if an assessing officer does not oblige you by issuing summon, then also the non-appearance of that person cannot be read against you. Or even if the summon has been served on him, still he chooses not to appear, then also this situation or his non-appearance now is not liable to be read against you. It's not liable to be used against you. So the art of pleading, that in such a situation, when you are so sure, ask the assessing officer. Use the good office of assessing officer to bring the evidence on record by requesting him to enforce the presence of a witness which you think or whom you think is very material and vital. As Somile said very nicely, that while making pleadings, the legal pleadings can wait. The issues of jurisdiction, unless of course it is territorial jurisdiction, they can wait. Issue of limitations may not be raised. Because these issues of jurisdiction, the issues of limitations, now they can be raised at any stage. Therefore, the art of pleading, depending upon a situation. Now, to what extent the legal pleadings be taken at this stage? I tell you, one of my very good friends, his wife's case was being assessed or was being reassessed under Section 147. the notice was received from, say, ITO 2 bracket 5, ward 5, say Mumbai, let us assume. The reason was recorded by the assistant commissioner, circle 4 bracket 5. Now, my friend, what did he do? He wrote in one of the letters to the assessing officer, sir, these proceedings are bad because here the reason has been recorded by assistant commissioner, whereas notice under section 148 has been given by an ITO. What happened? Now, even if you have not raised it before the assessing officer at this stage, and had you raised it before the commissioner appeal, or even before the tribunal for that matter, because it was a question affecting the legal jurisdiction, where the reason is being recorded by somebody, belief of escapement is being made by somebody, notice is being issued by somebody. No, it's not permissible in law. Now, my very good friend, having raised this issue before the assessing officer, prompted the assessing officer to temper the record. I am using this expression consciously, with full sense of responsibility. The records were tempered. The notice under section 148 was shown to have been issued by the assistant commissioner. Though that is a different matter that we would show with the help of so many other things that the record has been fudged in order to overcome this hurdle of the lack of legal jurisdiction on the part of the income tax officer. But now raising such legal jurisdictional issues, that too at a stage whereby you are prompting, though fudging of records, tempering of record is a very serious matter. And it is all the more serious when it is done by a public officer. But then, what I wish to emphasize at this stage, this is one instance. There are several and tens of instances now where the legal jurisdictional issues can wait. Can wait. And when I say it can wait, this waiting is in accordance with law. Had it not been in accordance with law, then I would have said this thing, or I would have said the same thing which I said in case of the lack of territorial jurisdiction, whereby the statute of the law requires us to raise this objection within a period of 30 days from the date of service of that notice. It's a legal jurisdiction. It's not a territorial jurisdiction. It's a legal jurisdiction which can be raised at any point of time. Therefore, the timing of raising of legal jurisdiction is also a very fine point of art of pleading in assessment and reassessment. In penalty, there is a concept of reasonable cause. Section 273 capital B. Most of the penalties are subject to section 273 capital B. Now, which penalties have been kept outside the scope of section 273 B are penalty under section 271 AED. Nowadays, the department's thrust, as per the news reports which appeared a few days back, that where input tax credits have been claimed or have been allowed to be claimed based upon the fake and first invoices. So if there is a penalty under section 271AAD, it has not been made subject to section 273B. Penalty under section 270A for underreporting or misreporting. 273B is not an answer to that penalty. But other whole hosts of penalties are subject to section 273B. Now, what is 273B? It says that if there is a reasonable cause for the commission of the default, whether the default may be non-maintenance of books of account, whether that default is for not obtaining the audit report and furnishing it within the due time, whether it is for accepting the loan or deposit, exceeding a particular threshold otherwise than through the banking channel, whether it's a penalty for repayment of loan or deposit, whether it's a penalty for receiving a sum of rupees 2 lakhs or more otherwise than through the banking channel. And there are other penalties. I need not to name each and every penalty in that sense. So reasonable cause, that if you as the counsel on behalf of your SSE, of course, by using the art of pleading, now make out a case, and of course, that case would be built on the facts. I'm not saying that the facts can be manufactured. Facts, in fact, cannot be manufactured. So if based on facts, you can turn that fact as a cause, not only as a cause, but then a reasonable cause, then your art of pleading can save your client from the levy of penalty. Not every cause is a reasonable cause. I always say that cause, which is essentially is to be based on facts, because these defaults are not committed for the sake of pleasure. There are some reason for it. And if that reason is made as a cause, and that too as a reasonable cause. Reasonable means a cause which is based on reason or which hits the reason. Reason of the person who is listening that reason. So if I am saying something as a reason before a person, before an adjudicating authority who is receiving that reason as a reason, then of course that reason becomes reasonable, and cause of course is there, must be there, you must have pleaded, and therefore that cause which hits the reason is a reasonable cause. So you must make that cause as a reasonable. Now in the matter of reassessment, you receive a notice under section 148. You ask for the, you file the return in response to that notice under section 148. You ask for the copy of reason recorded. And then you file objection. Though it is nowhere written under the Income Tax Act that you will follow this methodology. Supreme Court, by a judge-made law, though the judges do not make law, the judges interpret the law. But sometimes, some laws are even made by the judges. But then there is a reason for it. Supreme Court, in the case of GK and drive shaft, seems to have laid down this as a mandatory requirement, though it is not written in the statute, it is not written in the law. Now, what happens that against the notice under section 148, if an SSE is aggrieved that there is lack of jurisdiction, legal jurisdiction, then they tend to file writ petition. So in GK and Drive Share, the matter traveled up to Supreme Court. The Supreme Court said, oh, SSE, did you say all these things which you are saying before us or before High Court to the assessing officer as your objections? Because had you raised all these objections before the assessing officer, then assessing officer would have made those objections or may have had, or would have accepted those objections. And had the assessing officer accepted your objections, then there would have been no necessity of you filing the writ petition. Therefore, why don't you file your objections before the assessing officer before you file the writ petition? And since then, it has become the norm. It has become the judge-made law. Now, while making the objections before the assessing officer, you raise all possible objections which can be there. That there was no material based upon which you entertained the belief of escapement of income. Even if there was some material, but then that material cannot be said to be having live nexus with the belief of escapement. I mean, there can be n number of objections. You raise all those objections before the assessing officer. When you raise it before assessing officer, the assessing officer, if chooses not to dispose of those objections, let him not dispose, because then the non-disposal of objection now can be taken as an argument before appellate authority. And the courts have said, the Delhi High Court has said in more than one occasion, that the non-disposal of objections now itself would be fatal to the reopening, because that will be as good as the non-adherence to the mandate as given by the Supreme Court in GK and Drive Shaft. You raise the objection, he disposes the objections at the fag end of the passing of the reassessment order. The Bombay High Court has said in as many as four judicial decisions that if there is a period left from the date of disposal till the date of passing of the reassessment order less than 4 weeks, then such reassessment order is nullity. Again, this is a judge-made law. It is not there in the statute. Bombay High Court has interpreted that if you dispose the objection, at least 4 weeks time you should give before you pass a reassessment order. And probably that 4 weeks time limit, though it is not there in the statute, the High Court probably took into account that in case that disposal of objection wants to be challenged before the High Court by way of a writ, at least that much of time should be given to the SSE. So this distinction has to be kept in mind, that burden of proof is on whom, number one. Number two, the legal and jurisdictional issues can wait, but factual submissions, factual averment, factual evidences must be presented before the court of original jurisdiction. If you do not file factual averments and factual evidences before the court of original jurisdiction, and you take them as an additional evidence before the appellate authority, then you are, though Somila said half of the battle is lost, I would say that you are causing, or you have caused, a grave prejudice to the cause of your client. So we must be robust enough to raise the factual pleadings, factual evidences, factual material. It is the sum and substance of the law pleading. Come what may, on or before the conclusion of assessment, I must bring on record the factual evidences for it. The factual averment, factual pleading, factual evidences.
because this is the cementing or grouting the foundation. The stronger the strength of the building which will be erected on that foundation. If you have visualized all possible evidences and have brought them on record, let anything be done with respect to a particular issue by the assessing officer, now the faceless assessing officer, you have got enough cushion against such action of the assessing officer by making appropriate pleadings before the appellate authority. Even if the first appellate authority does not oblige you by giving relief, then you have got the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal, a wonderful institution. That institution, that if you ask me, I having been part of it, I have seen this institution from a close quarter. If there is a justice, it is at the level of Income Tax Appellate Tribunal. Sulabh Nyay, Satwar Nyay. Expeditious justice. But then for seeking that justice, you have to, as Swamil has said, regarding that stay petition. So this is the bottom line law, that wherever, in whatever petition, whether it is a stay petition, whether it is a condonation petition, whether it is a petition for admission of additional evidence, whether it is a submissions to be filed before the assessing officer in assessment, whether it is submissions to be filed before reassessment proceeding before the assessing officer, whether it is a reply during the penalty proceedings, mere saying would not suffice. Many times I have seen that my chartered accountant friends, my lawyer friends, they just submit their version of story. Assessing officer asks, explain the fall in gross profit rate. You just write an essay. Sir, the rates of raw material have gone high. We could not pass on the cost of material to our customers. There have been inflation of expenses because of the higher tariff of the electricity. There have been upward revision of wages. Now, you write a very long essay, and in an abstract form, if that essay is read, that makes a very interesting reading. But then, any factual submission in any letter, in any petition, unless supported with evidence, that is as good as throwing water in the sand. You must have seen that if you throw even a bucketful of water in the sand on the bank of Yamuna, you will find, it has disappeared. It has dissipated. Where has it gone? After a few seconds, you cannot make out that whether even a bucketful of water was thrown here. So submissions have to be made, have to be supported with evidence, and whosoever is diligent enough, vigilant enough, conscious enough, careful enough in visualizing the evidences, compelling the client to bring evidence so that you as a chartered accountant, authorized representative can put it. Now, that professional friend will win the race. And this is the art of pleading, that support your case with factual material and evidence. I think now it's 1 hour 40 minutes. There may be questions. Questions may be in the question box. There may be oral questions, and no seminar or webinar for that matter can be useful. It cannot be a unilateral lecture kind of a thing unless we invite the questions. The questions are asked unless it is made interactive. It cannot achieve its 100% utility. So, Didi sahab, मैं अपने मित्रों से ये आग्रह करूंगा कि आपके जो भी प्रश्न हो असेसमेंट को लेकर, अपील को लेकर, रिप्रेजेंटेशन को लेकर, आप बिल्कुल बेधड़क होकर, बेझिझक होकर हमसे पूछिएगा और हम अपनी यथाशक्ति हम आपके प्रश्नों का उत्तर देने में सक्षम हुए तो हम जरूर देंगे। तो डीडी साहब, सोमिल ओपन कर लो अपनी इसको। हाँ संदीप जी, आप अपने आप को अनम्यूट तो करो।
जी जी प्लीज सर।
संदीप, क्वेश्चन आंसर में तो कुछ नहीं है इसमें, देखो जरा।
हाँ जी, एक मिनट सर। नहीं, क्वेश्चन आंसर में सेशन में कुछ नहीं है सर,
कोई भी क्वेश्चन आंसर ही नहीं है।
आप अपना देखो, ये जो ये चैट बॉक्स में नहीं डाले किसी ने?
मैं देख रहा हूँ।
ये गुप्ता जी, अभी जैसे जो आपने जिक्र भी किया अपनी डेलिब्रेशन में, अभी पेनल्टी का जो आया है, अभी ऑनलाइन वो पेनल्टी का सिस्टम बनाएंगे, उसका क्या है थोड़ा सा बताएं, समझ में नहीं आया मेरे तो।
देखो, ऑनलाइन तो वही है कि इंस्टेड ऑफ जो बॉडीली फिजिकल असेसिंग ऑफिसर होते थे, अब वो कौन असेसिंग ऑफिसर है तो कोई ना कोई असेसिंग ऑफिसर ही, कौन है वो नहीं हमको मालूम है। जैसे सीएम एग्जाम की कॉपियां होती है, किसके पास गई क्या मालूम है।
बिल्कुल ठीक है। नहीं, फेस टू फेस में तो कह देते थे भाई हमारा ये कॉज है, वो कॉज है कि जो
ना ना जो कहते कहते वहां पर भी लिख के देते थे। देखो, असेसमेंट में या इनमें केवल जवानी जमा खर्च से कोई सेंस नहीं होता है, ठीक है ना। हमको तो अपनी बात को राइटिंग में कहना है, जिससे कि कल को उसको प्रूव करना पड़े। तो जहां पहले ओरली, जहां पहले फिजिकल भी होती थी, तो वहां ओरल नहीं होता था, वहां भी हम लिख के देते थे। और जो लिख के देते थे वो सिर्फ यू ही लिख के नहीं देते थे, जो आज हम लिखने की इम्पोर्टेंस की बात कर रहे हैं, ये पहले भी थी, हमेशा से थी, उसमें कहीं कोई बदलाव नहीं है, ठीक है ना। बस बदलाव उस एक्सटेंट तक है कि यदि हमारे सामने कोई अधिकारी है जिसको कि निर्णय लेना है, तो हमारी बॉडी लैंग्वेज से, उसकी बॉडी लैंग्वेज से, या हमको मालूम पड़ जाता था कि भाई वो इस पॉइंट पर कन्विंस नहीं है, तो हम और अपनी ताकत लगा देते थे उनको समझाने के लिए, भाई इस तरह से, उस तरह से। अब तो जो भी हमारी काबिलियत है वो हमको लिखकर ही देनी है।
तो आर्ट ऑफ प्लीडिंग समझनी ही पड़ेगी।
हाँ, वो समझनी पड़ेगी। बस आपका जवाब अब जितना अच्छा होगा, ठीक है ना, मैं ये तो नहीं कहता कि आपका जवाब यदि बहुत अच्छा हुआ तो एडिशन नहीं होगी या पेनल्टी नहीं लगेगी, लेकिन हाँ इतना मैं कह सकता हूँ कि आपके यदि जवाब और एविडेंस अच्छे हुए तो वो पेनल्टी लग जाएगी, असेसमेंट होगा, एडिशंस हो जाएंगी, लेकिन वो अपील में आपको छुड़ाने के लिए पर्याप्त आधार हो। देखो, कैबिनेट अथॉरिटी को भी वो प्लीडिंग चाहिए, वो एविडेंस चाहिए, वो जब ही छोड़ेगा, वैसे नहीं छोड़ देगा, ठीक है ना। तो इसलिए जो इम्पोर्टेंस है वो प्लीडिंग्स की, और वो बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट है, और वही हमने और सोमिल ने आज उसको हमने एक विस्तृत रूपरेखा के माध्यम से, विभिन्न उदाहरणों के माध्यम से, हमारे जो प्रैक्टिकल अनुभव हैं पिछले 35-37 सालों के, सोमिल का तो नहीं, सोमिल का तो लेकिन जो मेरा 35-37 सालों का और सोमिल को अभी काफी अच्छा अनुभव है, उसके बेसिस पे हमने आज ये सारी चर्चा की। और डीडी साहब, हम तो एक मिशन पर निकले हैं कि भाई जो भी
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल
प्रोफेशन ने सिखाया है, बड़े लोगों ने सिखाया है, अपने मित्रों के साथ हम शेयर करें, हमारी उसी भावना सर, के
एक क्वेश्चन आ गया है, मिस्टर प्रदीप गोयल हैं, चंडीगढ़ से। एसएससी हैज टेकन अनसिक्योर्ड लोन्स एंड द पार्टीज हैव आल्सो प्रोवाइडेड आईटीआर टू एसएससी, बट एओ आस्क फॉर सोर्स टू सोर्स ऑफ अनसिक्योर्ड लोन्स, व्हाट टू डू इन सच केसेस। ये तो पूछ सकता है।
देखिए प्रदीप जी, सोर्स ऑफ द सोर्स तो केवल शेयर कैपिटल और शेयर प्रीमियम के लिए मांगा जा सकता है। आप सेक्शन 68 का प्रोवाइजो पढ़ेंगे तो उस प्रोवाइजो में शेयर कैपिटल और शेयर प्रीमियम के बारे में तो है, सोर्स ऑफ द सोर्स की बात, लेकिन लोन के लिए तो आपको सोर्स प्रूव करना है, लेकिन आईटीआर देने मात्र से ही सोर्स नहीं प्रूव हो जाता है, ठीक है ना। आपके प्रश्न से ऐसा लग रहा है कि चूंकि आईटीआर दे दिया तो हमने अपना बर्डन डिस्चार्ज कर दिया, ऐसा लॉ नहीं है। बर्डन डिस्चार्ज होगा जो तीन तत्व हैं सेक्शन 68 के, आइडेंटिटी, कैपेसिटी और जेन्युइननेस, इन तीनों तत्वों को सिद्ध करने के उपरांत ही जो मेरे ऊपर बर्डन ऑफ प्रूफ है, सिद्ध करने की जो जिम्मेदारी है, वो तभी ही पूरी मानी जाएगी। तो सोर्स ऑफ द सोर्स तो नहीं पूछ सकता है। आपको ध्यान होगा कि एस हस्तीमल के केस में मद्रास हाईकोर्ट ने पहली बार 49 ITR पेज 273 सबसे पहले इस सिद्धांत को प्रतिपादित किया था मद्रास हाईकोर्ट ने कि स्रोत के बारे में आयकर अधिकारी को पूछने का अधिकार नहीं है। और उसके पश्चात फिर दौलतमल रावतमल 87 ITR 349 उस जजमेंट में सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने इस सिद्धांत पर मोहर लगाई थी। वो सिद्धांत आज तक प्रभावी है, आज तक लागू है। ठीक है, तो केवल रिटर्न का फॉर्म दे दिया वो अपने आप में पर्याप्त नहीं है। तो मैं ये कहूंगा कि यदि आपने सोर्स प्रूव कर दिया है, आपने अपने क्रेडिटर से एक कंफर्मेशन ले दी है कि वो इनकम टैक्स एसएससी है, उसने इनकम टैक्स की रिटर्न और उसकी बैंक पासबुक की रिटर्न कि वो पैसा आया कहां से उसके बारे में साक्ष्य यदि दे दिया है, एविडेंस दे दिया है, रिकॉर्ड पर ले आए हो, तो पर्याप्त होगा, है ना। उसके परे फिर वो नहीं मांग सकता है।
जी, नहीं, पासबुक अपनी या सर उसकी एसएससी की, जिसने लोन दिया है
अपनी में तो चेक से आएगा। जब उसने चेक से दिया है तो आपके भी चेक से आएगा
नेचुरली। और उसकी बैलेंस शीट अगर दे देता है कि भाई मेरे पास इतने सोर्सेज है, मेरा ये स्टेटमेंट ऑफ अफेयर है।
देखो, सोर्स का मतलब ओवरऑल सोर्स के बजाय स्पेसिफिक सोर्स जो हो रहा है, जैसे 68 लाख का लोन आया फॉर एग्जांपल, तो 68 लाख कहां से, बैंक पासबुक से दिखलाओ ना कहां से आए, और उसका बताएं फिर वो कहां से आए। सब उसके प्रॉपर्टी बेची या उसके पास आए, ठीक है ना।
ये संदीप, ये दो लोग हाथ उठा रहे थे।
जी, मैं वही कोशिश कर रहा हूँ सर। पहले प्रदीप गोयल जी को किया। प्रदीप जी, आप आवाज सुन रहे हैं? प्रदीप जी
हमारे चंडीगढ़ से मित्र हैं ये।
अच्छा,
आज इनका मैसेज आया था कि हमें लिंक भेजिए।
अच्छा, प्रदीप जी आवाज आ रही है आपको?
चलिए, वो चले गए लगते हैं। और पूछिए किससे।
हाँ जी, एक बीएस श्रीनिवासन जी हैं।
हाँ, यस बीएस श्रीनिवासन साहब, आई विल स्पीक इन इंग्लिश, प्रोबेबली यू आर फ्रॉम यस श्रीनिवासन सर,
प्लीज अनम्यूट कीजिए अपने आप को।
प्लीज अनम्यूट योरसेल्फ श्रीनिवासन सर। श्रीनिवासन सर, काइंडली अनम्यूट योरसेल्फ। वी आर फाइंडिंग ऑन द स्क्रीन योर स्पीकर क्रॉस्ड, प्रोबेबली अवर वॉइस इज नॉट रीचिंग हिम, और देयर मे बी सम टेक्निकल प्रॉब्लम बिकॉज ऑफ व्हिच इज नॉट एबल टू अनम्यूट।
Alternatively, he may write his question in the Q&A box.
Yes.
Srinivasan ji, if you are able to hear me, I would like to request you, please write your query in Q&A box. I think there is some issue. Sir, kuch issues hain. Sir, क्वेरी थी छोटी, है ना।
बताया ना।
तो इट्स अ वेरी जनरल क्वेरी, और नॉर्मली आप दिल्ली एनसीआर में तो यू आर फेसिंग सच क्वेरीज। होता क्या है कि मोस्ट ऑफ द पीपल, उनके पास पुराने प्लॉट या लैंड जमीनें पड़ी होती है, मकान पड़े होते हैं। तो दिल्ली में एक तो है कि LOI पे भी मकान पावर ऑफ अटॉर्नी पे भी मकान लेते हैं, लेके बना हुआ रहता है, कुछ रजिस्ट्री भी होती है। तो उन सारे सिचुएशन में क्या होती है कि उनके पेरेंटल प्रॉपर्टी होती है, वो सेल आउट करते हैं। और आफ्टर अ सर्टन लिमिट, जैसा हम सबको पता है कि जो तहसीलदार होता है, तहसीलदार यूज्ड टू शेयर ऑल दोज रिकॉर्ड विद इनकम टैक्स अथॉरिटीज। 30 लाख से ऊपर की है तो आपको सारी रिकॉर्ड
AIR इंफॉर्मेशन में जाती है वो।
हाँ जी, और इसके बाद क्या होती है कि इनकम टैक्स डिपार्टमेंट पहले तो लिमिटेड स्क्रूटनी के लिए मेल करती है, लेट नोटिस भेजती है, एंड देन अनलिमिटेड स्क्रूटनी को कन्वर्ट कर देती है स्क्रूटनी में। इन सच अ सिनेरियो, इन जनरल केसेस देखा गया है कि वो बहुत सारे डॉक्यूमेंट मांगती है। लेट सपोज अगर आपकी 1973 की प्रॉपर्टी है, इवन 1960 की प्रॉपर्टी है, तो आपने क्या लिया था, कब लिया था, कैसे लिया था। बट मोस्ट ऑफ द केसेस क्या होता है सर कि उनके पास बहुत ज्यादा होती है, प्लॉट की रसीद होती है, और जो उन्होंने बनाया होता है से दो मंजिला मकान बना लिया, तीन मंजिला बना लिया, तो उसकी कुछ कोई भी रिकॉर्ड नहीं होती है। इन सच अ सिनेरियो इन जनरल केस क्या होता है कि हमारे पास कोई भी क्लाइंट आता है तो वी यूज टू एडवाइस देम कि बॉस जस्ट हैव अ वैल्यूएशन, एक वैल्यूएशन तो आप करा के रखो, कि आप अगर एक वैल्यूएशन भी नहीं करा के रखोगे तो वी डोंट हैव एनी रिकॉर्ड एक्सेप्ट ऑफ दैट प्लॉट का, और प्लॉट की रसीद के अलावा तो कुछ तो है होता नहीं हमारे पास।
देखो उसका जवाब संदीप जी मैं देता हूँ
जी जी,
कि सेक्शन 55 में
जी जी
ये दिया हुआ है कि इफ एन एसेट हैज बीन एक्वायर्ड बाय यू प्रायर टू 1/4/2001
जी जी,
और इवन इफ यू मे हैव एक्वायर्ड इट बाय वे ऑफ इनहेरिटेंस आफ्टर दैट डेट बट देन द पर्सन फ्रॉम हूम यू इनहेरिटेड मे हैव एक्वायर्ड इट बिफोर प्रायर टू 1/4/2001
जी जी,
एंड इट्स फेयर मार्केट वैल्यू एज ऑन 1/4/2001 शैल बी टेकन एज कॉस्ट ऑफ एक्विजिशन। But then if there are stamp duty value available as on 1/4/2001 in respect of land or building, then this fair market value cannot exceed the stamp duty value. Okay. So that fair market value as on 1/4/2001 has to be taken as cost of acquisition.
Correct.
So even if you may not be having the comprehensive record proving the cost of acquisition or cost of construction,
correct,
but then you have got these evidence in the form of fair market value on 1/4/2001.
Okay, sir.
Okay, na?
थैंक यू सर।
ये कोई क्वेश्चन आया है, Q&A में दो हो गए हैं, प्रदीप गोयल सर का है। सर प्लीज अनम्यूट मी, आई हैव टू क्लेरिफाई वन इश्यू फ्रॉम डॉक्टर गुप्ता, आप उनको अनम्यूट करिए सर।
हाँ जी प्लीज जी जी, फिर प्रदीप
गोयल अनम्यूट करें, तो ऐसा नहीं श्रीनिवासन साहब को भी आपने अनम्यूट करना हो।
सर आई ट्राइड, मैं कर,
आप ही करेंगे अनम्यूट, वो थोड़ी कर पाएंगे अनम्यूट अपने आप को।
सर मैं कोशिश कर रहा
हूँ। हाँ तो कोशिश में कहीं ना कहीं कोई टेक्निकल वो है ये चीज का मतलब कि श्रीनिवासन साहब भी नहीं कर पाए अपने आप को, और
जस्ट अ मिनट,
हाँ होस्ट ही करता है
आई थिंक होस्ट,
अच्छा तो होस्ट ही नहीं है तो फिर तो कौन कर पाएगा।
नहीं नहीं होस्ट है, ये संदीप होस्ट है।
अच्छा होस्ट, जस्ट अ मिनट,
नया सिस्टम है ऐसा, मतलब पहले तो आ जाते थे, बात कर लेते थे लोग,
आ जाती थी, मैं एक बार ट्राई करता हूँ सर, नहीं हो
रहा। सॉरी प्रदीप जी, नहीं हो रहा, आप अलग से पूछ लीजिएगा मुझे, आप मेल मैसेज डाल दीजिएगा। श्रीनिवासन सर आप डायरेक्ट मुझसे पूछ लीजिएगा, मेरा मोबाइल नंबर 9810420515, 9810420515। तो अब बंद करें सर, 6 बज गए।
अभी नहीं बजे सर,
अभी नहीं बजे, अच्छा
देखे हो जाता है तो ये मालूम कर रहा संदीप उनसे, हो जाता है तो बेटर है। दो
नहीं नहीं बिल्कुल बिल्कुल तो बिल्कुल,
ये अनम्यूट ऑल आ रहा है, में क्या है यार ये, अब देखो प्रदीप जी, अब आप देखे ना जरा, बोलना प्रदीप गोयल साहब, मैंने अनम्यूट ऑल करा है, देखो शायद आवाज आ जाए।
आप बीसी श्रीनिवासन साहब को भी करो,
नहीं वो तो सारा अनम्यूट ऑल कर दिया मैंने।
अच्छा
है संदीप,
नहीं नहीं हो पा रहा कि, हाँ प्रदीप जी,
सर मैंने बोला है बस अभी जस्ट, हाँ प्रदीप जी का हो गया।
गिटार की आवाज आ रही है,
नेटवर्क इश्यूज हैं उनके।
प्रदीप जी नेटवर्क आपका शायद कुछ वो है, अनस्टेबल है
सर,
नहीं गिटार की आवाज आ रही है
काफी लोगों ने खोल लिया होगा ना।
प्रदीप जी नेटवर्क इश्यू हो रही है,
अभी अभी नोटिफिकेशन आया था कि वो पार्टिसिपेंट कैन अनम्यूट हिमसेल्फ। प्रदीप गोयल इज टॉकिंग, बोल तो रहे हैं शायद।
हेलो,
हाँ प्रदीप जी बोलिएगा, गुप्ता जी सुन रहे हैं आपकी आवाज, प्लीज।
सर अभी आवाज आ रही है?
आ रही है, आ रही है।
बोलिए प्रदीप जी।
सर आवाज आ रही है?
आ रही है, आगे तो बोलो सेंटेंस।
आपने बोला कि सोर्स में सिर्फ आइडिया से काम नहीं चलेगा, और जिसे लोन लिया उसकी बैंक स्टेटमेंट है, लेकिन उसके बावजूद एओ इज आस्किंग, तो उसके बाद जो उसके बाद जो एंट्री से और उसे
मांगते हैं, आवाज नहीं आ रही है,
ही इज नॉट गिविंग सच डिटेल्स. वो कहता आपको क्यों बताऊंगा मैं कहां से स्टेटमेंट क्यों दूं.
प्रदीप जी सॉरी, नहीं समझ पाएंगे, नहीं समझ पाएंगे, नहीं आ पा रहा, क्लियर नहीं आ पा रही.
आप क्वेरी बॉक्स में डाल दीजिए प्लीज, है ना,
क्लियर नहीं आ पा रही आपकी
आवाज़.
नहीं आवाज आ रही है लेकिन वो गिटार के साथ आ रही है ना, तो इसीलिए वो नहीं समझ में नहीं आ रही है.
हेलो.
हाँ प्रदीप जी, आवाज तो आ रही है लेकिन क्या है, बड़ी चली जाती है, आ जाती है, कट कट के आ रही है, इसलिए नहीं सुनाई पड़ रहा है.
श्रीनिवासन जी को ट्राई कर लेते हैं.
श्रीनिवास अनम्यूट नहीं है उनका.
श्रीनिवास नहीं, नहीं होगा,
नहीं अनम्यूट, ही विल हैव टू डू इट हिमसेल्फ.
सर एक प्रश्न मेरे से कोई एक पूछ रहे थे, एक साथी, तो उससे रिलेटेड नहीं है लेकिन ये विवाद से विश्वास स्कीम में क्या है कि अपील उसने फाइल कर दी, वीएसवीएस फाइल कर दिया
जी.
अब वो कहते हैं कि अपील को विड्रॉ करो, लेकिन वो जूरिस्डिक्शन वगैरह सारे बदल गए और वो कहां पर उसको विड्रॉ के लिए एप्लीकेशन डालें, एक ये प्रश्न आया.
नहीं वो अपील सीआईटी अपील में है, ट्राइब्यूनल में है,
सीआईटी में,
सीआईटी अपील में है. तो अब इसका क्या जवाब होगा, वो तो आप चीफ कमिश्नर को लिखो, कमिश्नर अपील जो भी इसमें है ना वो लिखो, उनको लिखो. अब ये तो डिपार्टमेंट को विड्रॉ करना है तो डिपार्टमेंट आपको बताएगा भाई ज्यूरिसडिक्शन कहाँ है इसका. क्यों सोमिल, क्या इसमें क्या बात है,
इसमें
थोड़ा टेक्निकल सा हो गया ये, क्योंकि वो तो वहीं से ले सकते,
आया होगा तो उनसे पूछ लेंगे, अगर प्रॉब्लम होगी तो वो एओ बता देंगे कहाँ है सीआईटी अपील,
जो विवाद से विश्वास वाले वो बता देंगे ना, उसमें हेल्प करना चाहिए उनको,
वो बता देंगे. अगर चेंज भी हुआ है, वैसे तो नोटिस सीआईटी अपील से आ रहे हैं ऑनलाइन,
उसका नोटिस नहीं आया है, वो फॉर्म 3 आ गया.
हाँ तो वो विवाद से विश्वास वाले लोग बताएंगे,
बता देंगे, एओ बता
चाहिए उनको ना.
हाँ वो बता देंगे, नहीं तो पोर्टल पे दिख जाएगा, पोर्टल पे चेक कर लें एक बार कहाँ है.
ओके
जी.
ये कनेक्टिंग टू आ रहा है अब, ये कौन है कनेक्टिंग टू में, एडमिन
जी, एडमिन.
अब देखो जरा इन दोनों, जो मिस्टर कौन से जी थे और दूसरे,
हेलो सर, श्रीनिवासन साहब को आप करें जरा अनम्यूट, और प्रदीप गोयल जी भी को भी करें, दो लोग ही तो प्रश्न पूछने वाले हैं और उनको हम अनम्यूट नहीं कर पा रहे हैं. देखो यदि कोई प्रश्न नहीं होते तो क्रेडिट स्पीकर को जाता है कि वो स्वयंभू.
अब आप क्रेडिट देना चाह रहे हैं पार्टिसिपेंट्स को, हैं वो लेना नहीं चाह रहे.
हेलो विनीत.
संदीप जी, श्रीनिवास राव जी को हमने अनम्यूट अलाउ कर रखा है, वो अनम्यूट करके हमसे क्वेश्चन पूछ सकते हैं.
और श्रीनिवास साहब,
अच्छा ठीक,
श्रीनिवास जी अनम्यूट करते हैं, आपके बॉटम ऑप्शन आ रहा है अनम्यूट का.
श्रीनिवासन सर, देयर मे बी सम अटेम्प्ट व्हिच इज टू बी मेड बाय यू फ्रॉम योर कंप्यूटर स्क्रीन टू अनम्यूट योरसेल्फ.
आई थिंक कुछ इश्यू है सर.
सर मुझे लग रहा है बस वो लॉगिन हो रखा है, क्योंकि कोई रिप्लाई. श्रीनिवास जी आपको कोई भी जो भी दिक्कत आ रही है वो चैट में डाल के बताएंगे हमें क्या इशू आ रहा
है. एक विकास विनीत, एक विकास मुद्रा जी बोल रहे हैं, देयर इज नो सच ऑप्शन टू अनम्यूट.
विकास जी बजट के लिए आपकी कहाँ कहाँ बुकिंग हो चुकी है एक तारीख के बाद?
ऑप्शन दे दिया जी,
क्या मुझसे पूछ रहे
हैं?
उससे पूछ रहे हैं
बजट एक तारीख को आएगा, उसके बाद आपकी कहाँ कहाँ ऑक्यूपेंसी हो चुकी है, बुकिंग आपकी है, बताओ जरा, फिर हम भी सोचें।
मेरी तो अभी ऑनलाइन ही है।
ऑनलाइन ही रहेंगे वैसे तो?
हाँ हाँ,
तो हम भी मतलब सोच रहे हैं, प्लान कर लें दो।
हाँ तो कर लीजिएगा, मेरे 2 तारीख को है मेरे, फिर 5 को है एनआईआरसी में।
ओके, एनआईआरसी तो शायद 2 को ही कर रही है आई थिंक।
नहीं, उनका मेरे पास 2 का नहीं है।
अच्छा, तो 5 को डिटेल्ड कर रहे होंगे या तो ऐसा।
हाँ हाँ,
तो संदीप जरा सोच लेना 3 या 4 तारीख को, फिर
हाँ जी
देते हैं। नहीं
जी जी, विकास जी आप अनम्यूट कर लें।
अरे वो कह रहे हैं देयर इज नो सच ऑप्शन टू अनम्यूट, उन्होंने मैसेज लिखा है ना।
हाँ जी हाँ जी,
विकास जी अनम्यूट कर चुके हैं आई थिंक।
नहीं है, वो तो आ रहा है स्पीकर कटा
सर, उसके बाद उन्होंने उनको अलाउ कर दिया। विकास जी आप अनम्यूट करिए अपने आपको, बॉटम लेफ्ट में एक माइक का सिग्नल आ रहा होगा जिसपे आपके पास एक क्रॉस लिखा हुआ, आप उसको क्लिक करेंगे तो अनम्यूट होएंगे।
एडमिन साहब, हाँ विकास जी अब हो गए शायद, फिर आ गया दोबारा एडमिन साहब। ऐसा होता ना तो श्रीनिवासन साहब, विकास जी ये सब कर लेते अपने आप को, कोई टेक्निकल एरर है।
श्रीनिवास जी आप कर पा रहे हैं? विकास जी एक बार अपने आप एक बार चैट में लिखेंगे क्या इशू आ रहा है?
प्रदीप गोयल जी कुछ बैंक स्टेटमेंट की बात कर रहे थे, या तो बैंक स्टेटमेंट उन्होंने दे दिया उसके बाद भी ये तंग कर रहा होगा या क्या है, कुछ ऐसे बोल रहे थे।
आई थिंक कुछ इशूज आ रही है, हमें
अब रिक्वेस्ट कर लो भाई अपना पर्सनल बात कर ले, राकेश जी ने ऑफर दे दिया है, या अपना भेज देंगे।
आई वुड लाइक टू रिक्वेस्ट ऑल मेंबर्स, आपकी जो भी क्वेरीज होगी आप राकेश जी से बात कर सकते हैं इधर थ्रू मेल और कॉल। और आई वुड लाइक टू रिक्वेस्ट आवर फाउंडर कन्वीनर सी दुर्गादास अग्रवाल जी टू प्लीज कंक्लूड द सेशन। ओवर टू यू सर।
चलो थैंक यू जी। देखो थोड़ी थोड़ी ठंड बढ़ गई कलकत्ता में, अभी राकेश जी का स्वेटर निकल आया। चलो सर, चलते चलते थोड़ा ये बताओ क्या मतलब, मेरे को तो लगता है कि काफी कुछ प्रपोजल्स जो है फाइनेंस बिल में आने चाहिए, तो व्हाट यू थिंक, जैसे बजट पूर्व सर्वे में क्या कहना चाहेंगे?
या इनका आया है सनी बहल जी का, ओनली 3 ऑप्शंस आर शोइंग, चैट, रेज हैंड एंड क्वेश्चन एंड आंसर।
चैट में चले जाएंगे? अच्छा, चैट, रेज हैंड, और रेज हैंड करके आएगा क्या संदीप? कैसे?
नहीं सर, उनको ऑप्शन दे दिए मैंने,
रेज
दे दिया है।
फेस कैसे दिखाना
है? आस्था जी की भी आवाज आ रही है, आस्था जी को भी ऑप्शन दे रहे हो?
आस्था जी, आस्था जी
एंड सनी सर भी कह रहे हैं वो ऑप्शन अवेलेबल है उनके पास अनम्यूट करने का।
Yes, now there is a message received, Sunny Behl sir का।
Sunny जी आप unmute करिए बाप, bottom left से।
आस्था जी का तो unmute है।
आस्था जी आपने कुछ query है आपकी?
Sunny sir unmute हो गए हैं, वो बात कर सकते हैं हमसे अब।
Hello।
Sunny जी।
Yes sir।
हाँ आप अपनी query पूछ सकते हैं।
There is no query from my side.
चलिए फिर कंक्लूड करते हैं। राकेश जी कुछ कह रहे थे बजट पूर्व सर्वे के लिए सर प्लीज।
देखो मैं समझता हूँ कि एक तो कुछ शेयर मार्केट ट्रांजैक्शंस पर टैक्स कुछ आ सकता है कैपिटल गेन पे, क्योंकि सरकार को रेवेन्यू भी चाहिए और साथ में कंजम्पशन का बूस्ट भी देना है, क्योंकि इस वक्त इकोनॉमी में कंजम्पशन का बूस्ट होगा तो प्रोडक्शन भी बढ़ेगा लोगों के हाथ में, इसलिए इनकम भी छोड़नी होगी। तो अब सरकार के साथ एक कोई लीगेसी या इनहेरिटेंस टैक्स भी आ सकता है, और कोई ऐसी भी है कि कोई डायरेक्ट टैक्स कोई मीडिएशन एज इनकम टैक्स ट्राइब्यूनल को अपार्ट फ्रॉम ये कोई मीडिएशन का भी कुछ ऐसा हो कि सेटल कर दो, जो सेटलमेंट कमीशन है सेटलमेंट कमीशन का ज्यूरिसडिक्शन तो लिमिटेड है, तो उस तरह की भी कुछ आ सकता है। तो सरकार के सामने चैलेंज होगा कि रिसोर्स कैसे मोबिलाइज करें और साथ में परचेजिंग पावर किस तरह से टैक्स पेयर के पास छोड़े जिससे कि कंजम्पशन को बूस्ट हो। तो देखो क्या नेविगेशन इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट ईयर, हालांकि एफएम साहब ने कहा तो है कि इट विल बी अ यूनिक बजट एंड यूनिकनेस शी सेड इन पॉजिटिव फ्रॉम द टैक्स पेयर्स एंड फ्रॉम द सिटीजंस पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू। तो लेट अस सी आई मीन व्हाट कम्स
नेचुरली। तो सर आप हमारा, राकेश जी और सुमिल जी, आप 3 तारीख को हमारा बुक कर दीजिए।
चलिए सर, ठीक है,
टाइम यही रहेगा।
बिल्कुल
अभी से फायदा ले रहे हैं।
हाँ जी।
आज आज मेंबर से जो रह गए हैं जेंटलमैन क्वेश्चन नहीं कर पाए हैं तो हमें खेद है, और 3 तारीख को राकेश जी फिर अवेलेबल होंगे। मीन वाइल आपका क्वेरी तो डिस्पोज हो ही जाएगी, फिर भी जो जिसकी क्वेरी है बिसाइड्स बजट, मैं समझता हूँ कि हमारे दोनों स्पीकर बड़े इस मामले में बड़े खुले दिल वाले हैं, उस दिन आप अपनी क्वेरी रख सकते हैं। और 3 फरवरी आप अभी लॉक कर लीजिएगा, बजट पे हम रखेंगे 2 घंटे का कंप्लीट। तो मैं जो है तहे दिल से राकेश जी का, सोमिल जी का, ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ ईस्ट दिल्ली स्टडी सर्किल, और मैं देख रहा था 200+ भी पार्टिसिपेंट हो गए थे, क्वेरीज भी थी लेकिन हम शायद उसको नहीं कर पाए, लेकिन आप अगर क्वेश्चन आंसर में डालते तो भी डेफिनेटली अटेंडेड।
करेक्ट सर।
तो इन्हीं शब्दों के साथ मैं सबका आभार और बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। हमारा कल के सेमिनार में फिर आइएगा, और ओवर टू संदीप जी, भाई कन्वीनर तो यही है, मैं तो ऐसे ही हूँ। फॉर्मल वोट ऑफ थैंक्स संदीप। आप
थैंक यू सो मच सर, थैंक्स अ लॉट, बहुत ही बढ़िया रहा। एंड फ्रॉम माई अर्ली डेज मैं राकेश जी को सुनता आ रहा हूँ, सिंस माई मतलब सी ए डेज से, मतलब जब से हमने किया था एक्सपीरियंस बोलता है ना, वो जैसे आप किसी चीज के बारे में आप बस एक्सप्लेन कर रहे हो, इट्स अ वेरी वंडरफुल और बहुत अच्छा लगता है सुनने में। थैंक यू सो मच सर आप आए वेबिनार में, थैंक्स लॉट आपने टाइम निकाला हमारे लिए, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। Second, we have Somil, and to tell you very frankly, I am very fond of Somil, and the way he speak and जिस हिसाब से इसने speed पकड़ी है Somil ने, and मेरी personal wish है Somil को, and I expect कि I believe कि Somil Supreme Court में कभी नजर आएंगे हमारे next मतलब Supreme Court judges
में। जाते तो होंगे भाई, ऐसा नहीं है जाते हैं, लेकिन हाँ अभी।
हाँ, I am not talking about तो सर जाने वाली। मैं बोल रहा हूँ सुप्रीम कोर्ट की जो जज होते हैं सुप्रीम कोर्ट में है ना, तो विल सी गोइंग इन फ्यूचर वी आर गोइंग टू सी सोमिल इन दैट प्लेस है ना। तो ऑल द बेस्ट टू सोमिल है ना, बहुत ही बढ़िया, प्लीज कीप इट अप, बहुत बढ़िया रहता है आपका है ना, और आप दोनों की जोड़ी तो सर कमाल की है ना, अच्छा चलेगा।
थैंक यू
सो मच सर, और ऑल पार्टिसिपेंट का भी बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, और डीडी जी आपका भी बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सर, थैंक यू सो मच
सर, थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू।